So we need to change mindset on what's going to happen. What are we going to do with this? We've got a lot of concerns about oil supply. Everybody out there right now is very concerned, and I've got some graphs here that are very startling about what the predictions are. World economy, this runs on transportation. Everybody has something to do with transportation, it seems like. And then cost of alternative fuels. What's it going to cost me to have this vehicle? This morning, just walking through the floor, everybody's saying, is there a tax incentive? Is it going to cost me more to drive this car? Where do I get fuel? You go by the Honda booth. They got a fueling station you can put at home. I have one at my house. I drive a natural gas Civic. Plug it in every night and every morning, I got a full tank of fuel. It's great. I've never been to a gas station in the last 2 years. So these are the concerns coming out. Health effects, air pollution, food and crop damage. Again, we've got a lot of fallout, CO2 damage. Everybody in California just dealt with Taco Bell. Taco Bell had to recall all their onions because of pollution in the water that was irrigating the crop fields. We just went through a spinach thing. So this is not isolated just to the automotive market. This is worldwide damage that's done from things that are associated with this type of fallout. Global warming is a really big concern. I've got some other slides on this. Driving the transportation industry. Well, this is a slide that came out of a couple different sessions, one with DOE that we just finished, and one with the Department of Labor, and one with the Economic Workforce Development. Number one reason through the DOE report 2005 was national security. Everybody's worried about national security now, having to bring a product in from out of country that is not homegrown. The number two reason was emissions, and preferably the global warming, which I just mentioned. And then breaking the dominance of import fuel and funding foreign wars. That was kind of thrown in there by one of the congressmen that I just talked to. National security, relying on foreign countries to supply a product. No economic sense out of this. Why are we buying products out of the country when we have a viable product in our country? And we are currently developing this product at a very rapid pace. Price gouging, limited supplies, and some things like that. Trade deficit imbalance. We've just been through an election here, and this was one of the big things. He was back in Mexico the very next day doing some of his trade agreements. So where does this oil come from? Surprisingly, our biggest supporter is Canada. And this was live as of last week. This is one of those pieces that I just brought up. What most people thought was is most of our oil is coming from out here. Whoops. Not doing it now. How about that? It's not working on me. Gotta love it. Most of the oils they thought were coming up between Kuwait, Iraq, and some of the UK. But you'll notice these are 5%, 2%. Kuwait, when they were burning the oil fields, we had this big, huge oil embargo thing saying, oh, they're burning the oil wells. What happened to the price of our gasoline? It skyrocketed. But 2%, do you think that's going to make a national problem? So I think a lot, in my opinion, a lot of these small things that we're seeing are affecting us, but there's a lot of price gouging, or there's a lot of overpricing. There's a lot of other things that are associated. I don't think it's from where the supply is actually coming from, but that would be my opinion. So how much of this oil really does the U.S. produce? This has been a very big topic of discussion. Washington, D.C., we just came off a Department of Energy panel. There's a couple of new panels and some new bills being released bring some more money into this. Surprisingly, the United States is the third largest oil producer right behind Saudi Arabia and Russia, but we don't import all our oil from Saudi or Russia. The oil comes in from Canada where they make it off of shale. It's compressed shale, steamed. U.S. Volumes here, you're looking at U.S. produces only 10.5 barrels per day on average, which is scary because I started looking at this and saying, well, how's that possible? Well, we have 75% of our nation's oil wells are what we call stripper wells. 423,000 of these wells are classified as stripper wells. And they're classified that because these wells produce less than 2 barrels a day. 75% of our volume comes from oil wells that produce less than 2 barrels per day. It's not very much. And this is why the cost of our product here in the United States is very high, because it's very limited on what we get out of it. That's the fun news. Emissions, well, this is something else. An internal combustion engine, as we all know, is probably one of the dirtiest manufacturers of energy that's ever been produced. It produces so much waste of friction and heat of what you get out of it. On a normal, and I'll go back, date myself back here, in 1970s, mid-70s, when I worked for GM, we did we called a product study. 40% of the power that engine produced went through the drivetrain, never made it to the ground. And that's lost off of energy and friction. So your gas mileage was being killed. 43% of the gas mileage took into compensation for friction and energy loss, never made it to the ground. Now, with the advent of our computers and what we've got today, the engines are running much more efficient. The numbers I'm hearing right now from American Honda is somewhere between 62 and 70% of the engine torque is making it to the ground now, not horsepower, torque. So they are getting much better. The engines are becoming more efficient. So what are our main emissions that we're seeing? Everybody knows these: carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, oxides. Sulfur, hydrocarbons, particulate matter, which has become a very big issue now with the PM12s or the PM5s and the PM regulations, especially through AQMD. Where does it all come from? This is a scary slide here. And again, this came right from the Bureau of Automotive Repair. This is one that they produced last year. 50% of the emissions are done through the automotive and or transportation area. Whereas a lot of people thought that the aircraft and some of the other areas, industrial processes, boils down to one of the areas. The miscellaneous processes down there in the bottom are manufacturing and something as simple as the foam that's coming out of the seat in your car. The materials your car is manufactured with have a natural emissions breakdown. So if you've ever been out to Palm Springs and locked your car up and not left that window down to vent, and you come back and there's a funny ooze on the inside of your windows, that's the emissions breakdown of the seats inside your car. This is natural. This is a natural product emission. And this is some of the FCs that were regulated many years ago. So that is where the miscellaneous process comes from, as well as aerosol cans, your VM counts or your VOCs, your volatile organic compounds in the aerosol cans. They emit up to about 15%, I was told, on a normal basis. So in 1990, our EPA decided that they were going to get in on this thing, and they passed this thing called the Clean Air Act, and they classified eight areas as alternative fuels. First one being battery-powered vehicles, that's solely battery-powered. Hybrid electrics, hydrogen-powered vehicles, fuel cell-powered vehicles, ethanol and methanol powered vehicles, a biodiesel, and natural gas, and the last one here is propane, or LPG. These are what Congress have documented as alternative fuels. So when we speak of alternative fuels, this is what we're talking about, those eight categories, and that's how the DOE and the DOL fund their grants and some of their structures that they do is based on those eight. So as you'll see as you walk around the floor here today, there's all the technologies that are out here, and they're all growing at a very rapid pace. And you as a consumer, some of these have incentives and some things to get you to buy these instead of buying the gasoline cars. One of the big myths, they're saying if we create biomass fuels, we're going to stop our independence on some foreign oil. I guess it's got some good points and bad points here. There's a lot of ways you can argue this, and Cornell University just did a research last year, documented in April or August of 2005. It takes 140 gallons of fossil fuel to plant, grow, harvest an acre of corn before you can make the biofuel with it. So oil already invested in that acre of corn, $1.05 per gallon, what you get out of that. So right off the bat, it's not economically sound if you're not getting a very large amount for that crop. On average, which we were just got in a conversation a little while ago, it takes 1.5 gallons of ethanol to give you the same BTU content a gallon of gasoline has. A gallon of gasoline has 17,200 BTUs, and it takes 1.5 gallons of ethanol to give you an equivalency to that. So saying that we're going to make all the biomass to get rid of the gasoline doesn't make sense, because we've got to make another half more volume. So yes, it is viable because we're using natural biomass products here that we normally throw away. It can be part of the solution, but by itself it's not a solution. And there's a little bit down here. If your car's getting 30 miles per gallon with a range of 450 miles, you only get 200 miles in the same size tank on ethanol. So the manufacturers put larger tanks in the cars for us. So because the public is used to driving 300 miles on a tank. So that's how your equivalency comes up. So we're not saving money because we just bought another half a tank. Love it. Again, I'm on campus here. I run the alternative fuels and I run part of the automotive lab. So we have a lot of demonstrations here, and actually you'll see there's a Miles Electric back there in the background right there. That's the white car that Miles donated to my campus. My campus did all of the research work on Miles when he brought it to us for training. So we do a lot of events. We have somewhere around 450 high school students that were bused in for this event right here, where we brought them in and got them introduced to alternative fuels. And from this event here, we went back and talked to the teachers 2 weeks later at the high schools, and all of a sudden the students are going around the campus saying, this needs to be changed because it's not economically sound or it's not environmental friendly. And the students started going back after the campus making changes. We need to recycle. A lot of the high schools weren't recycling their cans and their bottles, so the students have gotten very active on this stuff. And that is what it's going to take. That's what it's going to take to get the public more aware, is to bring this up with the students. This is, again, I'm not saying that ethanol is not a good thing. Please don't quote me like that. It's part of the solution. It's not the whole solution. But I think, in my opinion, a various area of all these technologies become the solution, not necessarily one. Being in Maine, in Portland, Maine, and coming out here to California, what works good in California doesn't work in Maine. Californians are not used to getting up to 20 degree below zero weather. I'm not. That was a shocker for me. What do you mean I got to ice my car? What do you mean I got to plug it in? The guy's out there with an electric blanket on the hood of his car. I'm thinking, what is this? I didn't get started the next morning. I had to call a rental car company and say, what do I do? And they said, get a taxi. I'll let it thaw out. So what works very good back east doesn't always work good for us out here. And you'll see California, we are the leaders of this technology. Our state, we are very fortunate right now to have a governor that came up through the community colleges. He is very active in the environment. The hydrogen highway is well funded now. It's working. It's making its path. So we're seeing more of a change. This was something that came out of DOE, the Department of Energy in California. This was a 1999 study that they did. California in 1997 produced 49% of its own petroleum. Alaska gave us 41% of that remaining need, and foreign oil imports were 10%. So this is where I go back to my earlier statement that biomass is not going to totally replace our dependency, but we are going to replace that 10% if we are more effective biomass-wise. California Energy Commission in 2005 now reports that 40.65% of this is now imported to fill our demands. So in a period of only a few years, we've gone from a very self-sustaining state to a state that's very dependent on other foreign oil. What's really scary is that 5% per month is what their predictions were, and right now it's about 3.2%. So we are still gaining on what we're using in the state. And this is kind of one of their scary little maps. It doesn't make a lot of sense sometimes, but you'll see as California's been tapering off and what we're doing, we're having to bring in more foreign subsidies. Now, foreign oil also means not only gasoline and crude, it's bringing in LNG and bringing in some of the other products like ethanol. Mostly ethanol is grown mid-states, so they have to bust that in or truck that in before we can use that here. What's that mean to California? Local economy's weakened. We don't have as many jobs here in this same industry. The supply is running out worldwide, so that means our deficit's going out at a greater economic rate. And energy costs are taking a larger chunk of families' incomes. We have students now that can't afford to go to school because they can't afford the gas to drive to school. And on our campus, we made an arrangement with Foothill, Los Angeles Metro, and Norwalk Transit that if I have a full-time student carrying 12 units or more, they get a free bus pass to come to school for that semester. I had 200 passes that were initially issued. We had 450 applicants. So the bus company stepped up, and I have 450 students who don't pay to come to my campus. And this is all because the bus companies do understand it costs money to drive these cars at $2 and $3 a gallon. World supply. This is a real big controversy, and I just got off with a group of guys last night that were just in a heated debate over this, and I don't know how the argument ended up, and I don't think it really did. Most of the people that are associated with this are saying somewhere between August 2004, the world peaked at its mass production. And it's been proven in a couple different areas, and we have a couple guys that are out making estimates on this. This is Lanvier here. Campbell was part of this one. His peak of production was August 2004. It's actually August 16th, 2004. The world peaked at production of oil. The next one I got here is Lanvier on his own, and this is his productions from 1930 to 2150. And now this thing was, this prediction was done quite a while ago. So, and then this is our department here. They're saying 2016. So you can see there's only an 8-year spread between what these people are saying. We're running out of oil. 7 out of 10 jobs in the world are associated with transportation. 7 out of 10. In the state of California, it's 8 out of 10 jobs are associated with transportation. Every consumer drove less than 10 miles, drove 10 miles less a week. That dropped that ratio by 14.6 on imports. This is Honda's hydrogen filling station down in Torrance here. And these guys have just been a leader getting things going. A little bit of history here, some of the RAV4 stuff. I'm going to skip through some of this here because I'm running out of time. In the 1800s and 1900s, this is when the electronic cars really had their heyday because people at that time didn't know how to shift gears and stuff. The electrics were very smooth, didn't have to require a lot of work to make these cars work. But after the gasoline cars came back and the price of this energy became so high, the gasoline or the electric was taken over by this. Now, we're looking at other things, the emissions coming up, electric motors and things like that on some of the hybrids. This stuff does help out quite a bit, and now we're recapturing regenerative braking, so we're kind of back to a partial electronics car again. Benefits of the hybrid stuff, I'm preaching to the choir right here. Everybody out here knows. If we can shut that gasoline engine off and run on a battery, it's more efficient. We're using less dependency on getting that engine going. Benefits, again, of this plug-in. This is actually the very first miles that was brought into the area here. And now, there it goes. This is the one we did all our research on at my campus. We're charging off peak hours now, so our cost of charging this car is a lot cheaper than if we're doing it. So we're back to that argument. Electric cars are going to raise the electrical rates in California. If we're charging off hours, it's actually cheaper. So if you figure the cost per gallons to charge that car between 1 and 4 in the morning, you'll be paying an equivalent of about 75 cents per gallon electrically. Series hybrid, I'm sure everybody understands there's a series. There's a parallel. One drives, one's in combination with it. So there's the two big changes out there. Hybrids under development. This came from UC Davis right now. That little Suburban that's back here in the background, that's a four-wheel drive electric, and that thing just screams. You'd never know it was on batteries. I've never seen electric mass of metal move so fast. The battery technology that's coming out of UC Davis is just incredible, the recapture rates and what they're doing with them. Ultra capacitors, they will eventually take over a lot of what we're doing with batteries. This is the city of Santa Monica's car out there, and you'll see some of the stuff that Quantum's doing for them. And then Arnold down there in the bottom with his hydrogen Humvee. Quantum's, they have a booth out here, and I've done a little bit of research, and some of the people have come back and asked lots of questions. They're taking some of these things. They are OEM working. They've got, Santa Monica's got quite a few of them. They've got a very large fleet of these where they've taken the gasoline portion out, and they're running them on hydrogen in combination with the hybrid. And they've also got one that's run on battery pack. It's a plug-in unit, too, that they're doing some research work. So there are a lot of companies out here doing a lot of good research. And then California Fuel Cell Partnership was another one, too. I'll talk a little bit about that. First fuel cell in 1838, the Grove cell is what it was called. Very, very crude, done through vacuum tubes through a polymer membrane. At that time, they did not know what a polymer membrane was and what its effects could be. So they ran their electronics through vacuum tubes. So we lost a lot of energy just for heat loss on those before the whole thing came about. California Fuel Cell Partnership, I believe they're out here too. This group of people probably have done the biggest, I guess you would say, outreach of getting all the manufacturers together. Can you imagine getting 13 manufacturers together and agreeing on something, much less 31? Everybody's got a better source. Everybody's got a better product. But to get these guys together and come together as a common thing, that was a heck of a feat for these guys. Fuel cell workings, some real simple stuff here. This is the early-based FCX. This is our PEM cell, which you guys are all looking at little black boxes out there going, ooh, this looks cool. This is what it's doing right here, and this is how the electrical load is, or electronics are actually put together. This is a real simple animated version of it. When you come through some of our classes, I have two classes dealing with PEM cells and membrane stuff. The guys get in and actually can burn their hands on this stuff. It's great. They really respect electrons after that. Ethanol, we've talked quite a bit about this. Henry Ford's first built his quadricycle to be powered with ethanol. The gasoline was very expensive at that time, and the gasoline was sold in drugstores in pint jars. So if you wanted gasoline, you had to go to a drugstore and pay for it in a pint jar. Ethanol was very available because most of the farmers had stills, and they were making biomass fuel out of their farms. And this is where Henry Ford came back and said, you know what? We could do this and put it in cars. So this was really one of his first ideas. So ethanol's been around for a long time. We've been running cars on alcohol for quite a bit. If you're a person of the 70s, it became gasohol because it was a mixed brand. Now it's called E85 or E10, depending on who you talk to, because it's still a blend, but now the ethanol blend sounds a little more technical than gasohol. This is off DOE's website also. The amount of corn used each year to produce ethanol represents only 5 to 7% of the current annual production, so no, we're not getting rid of food crops. There's plenty of corn out there to go around. It's just a very small portion of what's being used in the market out there, and it's growing very quick ratio. Methanol, well, if you're a local of California, you'll recognize that drag strip right there. I grew up on that drag strip. It's now a shipping terminal, but methanol is used mainly in high-performance cars. It's not a very good product that we use. You do see it in cans of Sterno and some things like that, windshield washer fluid. And this year, AQMD's had a regulation that the dry cleaning solvents that they use to dry clean your clothes, they now become more of a methanol-based. Biofuel, we'll go through this real quick. And I'd say Willie Nelson's probably the biggest pusher of this right now. You'll see his bus come up, and he's got his little truck behind him making it from every McDonald's they stop at. Biofuel, what is it? Biodiesel is a fatty acid, and it's used a transesterification to make this back into a viable product that they can blend back into a petroleum base. That's a real simple explanation. It works very efficient. One thing from this airport right now, I did a Google search. I can buy biofuel right here in Wilshire Boulevard. There's 7 places within this airport, within a 50-mile range, that I can buy biofuel. So that is a very known, a very good product, and it's becoming more readily available to us out here. National Biodiesel Board, they've got a biodiesel board out here, one of the events out here. Stop by if you really want some more information on it. They've got some stuff, so some tax incentives and some things like that if you do set up. And I'll go through this compressed gas real quick. Compressed natural gas, this is my biggie. Right now there's 1,300 stations in Southern California. I drive natural gas for the last 5 years. Honda has been very supportive of us. They gave me a brand new car to drive this weekend, 2007. There's all kinds of incentives on it. Home fill units, this is a picture of the fill unit. High pressure tanks, everybody's worried about pressure in the tanks. These tanks are regularly tested. It takes an armor piercing bullet to go through one of these tanks. Same thing with the hydrogen tanks. Hydrogen tanks are very highly regulated. A gasoline tank in your car will shear at 4 pounds of pressure. So if you hit a piece of wood on the freeway, you can punch a hole in your tank very easily. These tanks here take anywhere, well, a 3,600 pound tank doesn't burst till 8,000 pounds of pressure. So it takes quite a bit of energy to go through one of these. I feel much safer with my wife in a car that has this tank behind it than a gasoline tank. Many of the large fleets I talked about, these are just some of the fleets that I've actually been out doing some tests or training on. There's a handful of them there. LA City, they got one of the first large cities to make a major push for natural gas and hybrid type technology. Natural gas, this goes in a little bit more and talks about liquid natural gas, which is a negative 259 degrees below zero before the gas becomes a liquid. A lot of the transit and trash companies use that. Again, it takes 1.3 gallons to be equivalent to 1 gallon of gas. Not as much as ethanol, but there's still a little bit of energy loss. Propane's been around forever. A lot of the buses and some of the people are using it still. It's still a very viable product, and as I said earlier, there's not one solution here. Everything together becomes a big solution. And here's my answer to that. it's going to take a combination of a lot of things to get this job done right for us. It's not going to be one thing. I can't stand up here and look at you and say gasoline's going to go away, diesel's going to go away. It's still going to be around. It's going to be around, but it's going to become very expensive to use because of the limited sources of it. For us to use what's in our backyard, our biomasses, our natural gases and things like that, electricity, things that are generated for us, this is what's going to solve it. We're reducing our emissions and our pollution by doing that. And there's some of my references here. If you want to know anything about this, again, this stuff will be on the web. And if you want to give me a business card or something, I can send you a direct copy of this. There is just tons of information out there on this type of stuff. Suggested reading. Everybody's probably been through this. I think I'm speaking to the choir again. Not too many people are aware of Tim Flannery, The Weathermakers. That is a great book. That really opens your eyes to a global warming product. And this is more research stuff here. And there's my website. Down at the bottom, if you want to see any of this stuff, it will be on the website here by the end of the month. Or if you want to stop by the booth and talk to me, I have a booth outside also. I can answer any questions or anything out there at the time. And that's my presentation.